You mentioned oracles when you were talking about Augur and the relationship between Gnosis and Augur. Can you explain briefly what oracles are and what decentralized oracles are?
Sure. So if you think about blockchain, blockchain is just like a data store in the end, a secure data store. And blockchain by itself doesn't know about events that happens outside of blockchain, right? So for example, if you have a prediction market about who will win the Champions League, then the blockchain doesn't know the result. And someone has to make this information available on blockchain. And this entity is called Oracle, for whatever reason. It was named Oracle, but it's called Oracle. And this entity is allowed to specify the result of or this information on blockchain that can be used then to resolve a prediction market, for example. And now there can be different types of how an oracle can be implemented. The simplest would be you just define a private key that is allowed to set this result in the end. So it could be just you or me. We are allowed to define the final result. But of course, there's an issue with trust if you do this, because then the result is actually defined by a centralized entity. And if you have a decentralized prediction market, then maybe you don't want to have a centralized entity to resolve the prediction market, but because essentially the centralized entity becomes custodian of the funds within the market. Because if the centralized entity would, for example, buy like the opposite outcome of what is actually the factual outcome,
yeah,
and then resolve to this outcome, they would get all the money.
Uh-huh.
That's why they are kind of custodian of funds. Mm-hmm. And that's why you probably don't want to have a centralized oracle. You rather would like to have a solution where there's more than one entity involved, something more decentralized. And that's also something that Augur looks into, like how can we build a decentralized oracle where it's a group of people defining the final outcome in a specific process. You can also combine decentralized and centralized oracles. So if you think about centralized oracles, they have two advantages. One is they are fast and cheap, probably cheaper than decentralized oracles. And that's good for most use cases, especially also because you can leverage already existing reputation that exists outside of blockchain. So for example, if you have a market, a futures market of any kind of asset, then maybe Bloomberg, for example, offers an oracle solution for this.
Mm-hmm.
And then even if Bloomberg is a central entity to resolve the market, you can still trust them. Because if they would publish wrong information, everyone would know this forever,
mm-hmm,
because it's on the blockchain and they would lose a lot of reputation. So there are entities that basically, if you are a centralized oracle provider, and you resolve markets to wrong outcomes, and you lose reputation, and that's why you have reputation at stake.
Yeah.
But yeah, you can also combine both. You could also say, let's use a centralized oracle first, and then we just allow for swapping the centralized oracle with a decentralized oracle in case the community disagrees with the outcome that was set by the centralized oracle. And this way you have both advantages. You have the advantage of having a cheap and fast oracle first, and you have the advantage of having the security of a decentralized oracle in case the centralized oracle fails for some reason.
Yeah.